Hello.
Okay.
You are now unmuted.
So in the last lecture, we have discussed about. Okay. So in the last lecture, we have discussed about the AC input module. Basically, what happened? We have connected the inputs of various sensors, switches, or something to the PLC. As I want to automate my system, so for that purpose, for doing the automation of the system, we need to first give the input, then we need to process it, and then you will get the output. So these are the three basic components of your industrial automation: input, process, and output. So for giving the inputs, we are going to use the various input sensors or devices. My input devices may be on-off switch, my input devices may be limit switches, my input devices may be proximity switches, it may be temperature sensor, okay, so or pressure sensor. So, and you are going to use a number of input devices. Now, when you are going to make the connection of these input devices to the PLC input module, how you are going to make? So, first, say this is my phase and this one is the neutral. As we are going to discuss the AC supply, so AC supply has two terminals, phase terminal as well as the neutral terminal. So, L1 represent my phase and L2 represent my neutral. So, when in this case, if you are going to observe, L2 is connected to the common terminal of the input module. Now, why we are going to do that? If I am not going to use this one, so what is the problem I am going to face? If I want to connect the 8 inputs, I require 16 wires, okay, if common is not there, okay, because for each inputs I require 2 wires. But when I am going to make it common terminal common, my neutral is common, so at that time what is going to be happen over here? So in that case, the connections are going to drastically reduces. As connections are reduces, because this will provide the return path to all the signals. Okay. Now, how it will provide the return path to the signals that we are going to discuss over here. Now, here, if this switch is going to be activated, at that time the current will flow from L1, L1 to this sensor to IN1, and all these devices are internally connected with each other, with the common terminal. Okay. So, my current. Okay, so how it is going to be happen? Just like this. So if my current is coming like this one, even this is going to be closed. Okay, if it is closed, then my current will flow from IN1 to common and IN2 to the IR2. So this is the path for the flow of the current. Okay, so in the same manner, all the input devices, all the inputs are connected to the common by means of such type of connections. So this may be one connection over here. These are internal connection inside the circuitry. Okay, so with this, what happened? The number of wires required will reduces, and the complexity of my circuit is going to be reduces with this one. Now, the next thing that we are going to discuss is that when I want to give the input supply, that is AC1, my AC supply may be 110 volt, or it may be 220 volt or 230 volt. Okay, so in that case, what happened? My PLC works only on 5 volt DC, but if I am giving that large voltage, that is 230 volt AC, to the PLC, my PLC will get instantly damaged. So to avoid that, what I am going to do, I need to convert that 230 volt AC supply or 110 volt AC supply into 5 volt DC supply, which is given to the PLC. So for that purpose, if you are going to observe over here, we are going to just put a resistance, these two resistance. These two resistance are used to reduce the voltage. If my voltage is say 120 volt over here, okay, 110 volt or 220. Now, what is going to be happen? Here I am getting only 5 volt. Okay, here I am getting only 5 volt supply. This resistance will drop the voltage over. This is my input device. Now, this 5 volt is still AC supply. Okay, this 5 volt is still AC supply. But I want DC supply, so I am going to use the bridge rectifier. So bridge rectifier will convert my AC supply into pure DC supply, or AC supply into DC supply. So basically, at the output of the bridge rectifier, I am going to get this one. Okay, full bridge rectifier. Now, this is my filter circuitry. R2 and C is my filter circuitry, which will smooth the DC. And at the end, I am getting such type of output over here, pure DC. Then this pure DC is given to the photo transistor. Now, what is the function of this, say, LED? This is the optocoupler unit or the opto-isolator. What is the function of this? Whatever the DC supply is going through that, it will illuminate this lamp, and when this lamp will glow, at that time it emits the light. the light fall on the photo transistor. Now once the light fall on the photo transistor, this photo transistor will make it off. Okay, so when this transistor T1 is on, when this start transistor, photo transistor start conducting, when the light of this LED fall on the base of this photo transistor, this transistor start conducting. Okay, once this transistor start conducting, T1 goes off, and when T1 goes off, that VCC 5 volt is available over here, and this is given to the PLC. So this is basic working of your AC input module that we already discussed in the previous lecture. Okay, so now what we are going to do, we will discuss the working of your DC module. Okay, so in case of DC module, what you are going to do, a rectifier unit is not required because already my supply is the DC supply over here. Simply I need to reduce the voltage level, because the voltage level which is used for the DC module may be 24 volt DC or it may be 40 volt DC. So instead of using that, I am going to use, say if I am directly giving 24 volt DC to the PLC controller, in that case my PLC will get damaged. So if you are going to see the connection diagram for this one, is same as that of the connection diagram of AC module. Instead of phase and neutral, it has positive and negative terminal. Okay, so instead of phase, it has positive. Instead of neutral, it has negative. L1, L2, it has positive, negative. So the connections are same. So if you are going to see, this first input device is connected in between the positive and the first input, and these are internally connected. So same the color, my current will flow. If this device is in operation, say now my current will flow in this direction, okay, through common to negative. Okay, so this is the flow of current. Now we are using a single common to reduce the complexity of the circuit. Next that we are going to discuss over here is how this DC module will exactly work over here. Okay, so for that purpose, what you are going to do over here, I will just draw the diagram for the DC input module. So in case of the DC input module, if you see over here, so this is my 12 volt DC supply or 24 volt DC supply. This may be 12 volt DC or it may be 24 volt DC, depending on your applications, whether your devices will operate on 12 volt or 24 volt. Now the question arises, why you are going to use the different supply for activating the devices and different supply for PLC? So the basic reason is that my devices, input devices, are located at certain distance from the PLC module, and if I am going to actuate all the devices at 5 volt, then my devices may not get actuated at 5 volt, and I need to transfer the signal over this comparatively larger distance, so that causes the voltage drop. Okay, so as voltage drop is there, so that may result into the maloperation of the PLC. So to avoid that, I am going to use the actuating voltage for the input devices, that may be 12 volt or that may be 24 volt. Now here, say imagine we have 12 volt over here. Now these resistors, again these two resistors are used to reduce the voltage. Okay, so these two resistors will reduce the voltage from 12 volt to 5 volt. Okay, so this is the diode which does not allow us to flow into the reverse direction over here. Okay, so this is called as a freewheeling diode also, but that we are not going to discuss over here. Now this 5 volt is given to this indicator. There are two indicators. One is the status indicator, which will show whether the input is active or not. If the input is available at that time, the LED will glow, and when the input is not available, then the LED does not glow. So these status indicators are used to troubleshooting purpose, whether that particular input available or not. Okay, so then when the input is available, when this limit switch will get operated, at that time this LED will glow, and when this LED will glow, it will emit the light, and when this it will emit the light, this transistor will on. When this transistor is on, this transistor becomes off. Okay, and when this transistor is off, at that time the 5 volt supply is available at the Vout terminal, and which is given to the PLC. Okay, so this is basic working of your DC input module. Will contain the 8 number of electronic circuit and DC input module like that. If you are going to start the operation, again I am going to repeat it once more. So this 12 volt or 24 volt supply is there, either 12 volt supply or 24 volt supply is given to this one. Now this, when the device will operate, at that time the supply is available over here. There are two resistors. These resistors are used to reduce the voltage from 12 volt or 24 volt to the 5 volt based on whatever the supply is available over here. So this 5 volt supply is given to the LED. Okay, so the LED will glow. When this LED will glow, it will indicate that particular input is available or not. If the LED will glow means input is available. If LED will not glow means input is not available. So after that, what is going to be happen over here? The current will flow through the LED of the opto isolator or opto coupler. This LED will glow. When this LED will glow, it will emits the light. The light will fall on the base of your photo transistor. When the light will fall on the base of the photo transistor start conducting. Okay, so it will behave like the on switch, and when it will become the on switch, the current will flow through this one, and when the current will flow through this one, this transistor T1 get off. Okay, so this is transistor T1. When this transistor T1 get off, what happens? The supply is available up to this point, and this is given to the PLC. Okay, so processor, actually this supply is given to the processor. So whatever is going to be happen over here, these two sections are completely separated from each other. These are electrically isolated from each other. They are electrically isolated, but they are coupled with the help of light. So these are called as the optocoupler. Now, even though if some problem arises in this section that does not damage my PLC processor, that will damage the only this much section, and it is can be easily replaced or it can be easily repaired. Okay, so this is your DC input discrete input module. Now we are going to discuss the discrete output module. As there is a discrete input module, in the same manner we have discrete output modules also. Okay, so now DC discrete output module can be AC or DC. If you are going to say my output module may be AC type or DC type in the same manner as my input module. Just like my input module may be AC input module or this may be DC input module. In the same manner, my output may be AC or it may be DC. DC output module may be your buzzer, DC output module may be your scooter, DC output may be your indicating lamps. Okay, and DC output AC input output module may be your solenoid, AC input module may be your say motors. Okay. Lamps like that. So based on your requirement, you can use go for the output module that may be AC or that may be DC. Both types are available in wide range of voltages. Whether you can go for the AC or DC, these are available at the wide range of voltages. They may be available 12 volt, 24 volt, 48 volt. Okay, they're 110 volt, 230 volt. The function of DC output module is to energize the output devices such as motor, starter. What is the function of this one? The function of DC output module is to energize the output devices. What are these output devices? My motor starter coil, it may be pilot light, it may be solenoid valve, etc. Connected at the terminal when the processor places binary 1 in the memory location assigned for that particular device. Okay, so when it is going to be energized, these output modules or output devices such as your motor starter coil, pilot light, solenoid valves will get energized. Okay, when the processor will place a binary 1 in the memory location. Binary 1 means what? Your logic high. Logic high means the it should be on state. Okay, in the memory location assigned for that particular device. The cost of output module is proportional to the number of terminals provided for connecting the output devices. Now, definitely what happened, if I want more output devices, my cost of the output module go on increasing. Okay, the cost of 4 output module is less than the cost of 8 output module. As the number of output terminal increases, the cost is also increases. The standard terminal available are 4, 8, 16 and 32. If I am going to use the micro PLC, mini micro PLC or brick PLC, in that 4 output is available, 8 output is available, 16 output, 32 output terminals are available. The output module has continuous current rating. Now, this is important over here. My output module has continuous current rating for each terminal as well as continuous overall rating for the module. Okay. These output modules has two types of current rating. One is the continuous current rating for each terminal. Means what? This module can sustain the continuous current of 5 ampere or 2 ampere, whatever the rating of that. Okay, for each terminal and overall rating for the module. Okay, say if you are going to say that a single terminal can carry, safely carry 5 ampere of current continuously, okay, and it has 4 terminals, okay, so what is the overall rating, what is the continuous overall rating for the module? Okay, yes, anyone? If the continuous current rating for one terminal, if the continuous current rating for one terminal is 5 ampere, assume, we are assuming that if the continuous current rating for one terminal is 5 ampere and if the module has 4 terminals, what is the overall rating for the module? What is the overall rating for the module? Sakshi Shailar? Sakshi Bongre? Trushar Bangar? So it may be 5 into 4, we have 4 terminals and for one terminal it is 5 ampere. So 5 into 4, that is 20 ampere is the overall current rating. Okay, so in this way we can calculate, these ratings are specified. Then third rating is specified over there. The third rating is the surge rating. It also specified, indicating that the maximum current that can be allowed to flow for the specific time. Okay, so what is the maximum current that can be allowed to flow through the circuit for a specific duration, for 10 millisecond, 20 millisecond, like that one. Okay, so a typical current rating of 240 volt AC module would be 1 ampere maximum. Okay, so if you are going to consider the typical current rating, so normally as these are used to only energize the walls of the solenoid, okay, stator coils, so typically the current required is less. So most of the AC module have 1 ampere maximum continuous duty with surge current of 3 amperes. Okay, so if you are going to consider that 1 ampere current is the maximum current which can be sustained continuously by a single terminal of your output module. Okay, because that is the sufficient current required to energize the starter coil, pilot light, solenoid walls. Okay, and with the continuous duty of surge current, nearly 3 times the surge current. Surge current is nearly 3 to 4 times your rated current. So it should be nearly 3 amperes. The output modules are provided with fuse to protect the overcurrent, short circuit and ground faults. So if you are going to observe over there, what are the output modules that you are going to use? These output modules are provided with the fuse. Okay, each and every output module is provided with the fuse. For what purpose? To protect against the overcurrent, against the overcurrent, short circuit and ground fault. Okay, so the purpose of fuse is what? The purpose of fuse is the protection. Protection from what? Protection from the overcurrent, protection from the short circuit, protection from the ground fault. Now if you are going to observe this, in case of short circuit also and in case of ground fault also, your circuit current will increase. So basically fuse will provide me the protection against the increase in the current. Okay, that increase in current may be due to overload, that increase in current may be due to short circuit fault, or this may be due to ground fault. The number of fuse used vary from with each manufacturer. Okay, so how many numbers of fuse are going to be used, that can be vary from manufacturer to manufacturer. In some module only one fuse is provided for all output, while in other individual fuses are provided for each output. Okay, in some cases what they are going to, some manufacturer will provide the single fuse for all the outputs. If I have all 8 outputs, then the manufacturer will provide only one fuse. Okay, but some manufacturer will provide a dedicated fuse for each and every output. Means if I have 8 output, then they will provide the 8 fuse, one fuse for one output terminal. Some manufacturer do not provide any fuse, so external fuse must be connected. Okay, now whatever the PLC that we are going to use our lab, that we are going to use the LogoSoft 8. So in case of Logo 8, they does not provide any fuse. Okay, so Siemens Logo series does not provide any fuse. So in that case, we need to provide the external fuse. Okay, but in that case, they have mentioned in the user manual that when you are going to use the PLC for commercial application or for, say, certain applications you need to provide the external fuse. This is clearly mentioned in the user manual. Okay, so when you are going to purchase the PLC, at that time please check the user manual whether they have provided the fuse for output or not. If you are not going to use the fuse, that may damage the output module circuitry. Blow fuse indications is also provided on most of the PLC. Okay, so in case of some PLC, they are going to provide the blow fuse indication. What does it mean? When my fuse will melt, when my fuse will just damage, at that time, that way the LED will glow on the PLC. Okay, so we come to know that we need to replace the fuse now. Okay, so blow fuse indication is provided by most of the PLC. Some PLC have only one blow fuse indicator, while other have blow fuse indicator for each individual output, thus simplifying the troubleshooting. Now in some cases what happens, some manufacturer have provided only one blow fuse indicator and some manufacturer provided the blow fuse indicator for whatever the number of output. If you have 4 output, then there are 4 indicators. If you have 8 output, then there are 8 indicators. Okay, so they will provide you the blow fuse indicator for each individual output. Now, what is the purpose of this? The purpose of this is that it will simplify the troubleshooting process. If my process is not working in the proper manner, then just by checking the status of this blow fuse indicator, I come to know that there is a certain problem associated with the particular output device. Okay, say assume that my Q2, okay, second number of output is not energized. Okay, so when I'm going to check the PLC, if the fuse blow fuse indicator for Q2 is active, then I come to know that the second number indicator fuse was blown. So I need to replace that fuse, and after replacing the fuse, my system will properly work. In the same manner, the status indicators are also provided in the module to indicate the status of any particular output. Okay, some modules have 2 status light for each output point. Okay, so this is very, very important. Remember, these 2 points are very important because this is the actual thing which you need to use in the industry during troubleshooting process. Basically, when you are going to join the industry, at that time you are not supposed to program the PLC or something, because already the system are automated in most of the cases, unless and until you are not appointed as a PLC programmer. So you are if you are going to be work in the organization as a maintenance person or trainee, you need to just maintain the machine in the working state. And for maintaining the machine in the working state, you need to find out the troubleshooting and all these things. So status indicator plays a very important role in case of the troubleshooting for the PLC based system. So status indicator light also provides in the module indicate the status of any particular output. It will show whether the output is activated or unactivated, or energized or unenergized. Some modules have 2 status indicator light. Okay, one light is referred to the logic light and other as the output light. Some PLC have 2 lights. One is for output, that will show as per the logic my output is available. Okay, that is called as the logic light. Kahi PLC madhe status indicator output la, output module la status indicator madhe 2 light hai. Jo pehla light hai to logic light hai, means there is no logical error in the execution of the program of your system. Whatever the logic you have written, that is correct, and as per the logic your system is properly working, but there may be some problem in the output side. Okay, so second LED is there, that is called as the output light. This light will glow only when the actual output is energized. If the output is not energized, then the light does not glow. Okay, so the first light will show your logic error and second light will show your physical error. Okay, when the logic lamp is lit, it indicates logic is turned on and output device has been sent from the processor. Output to the device has been sent from the processor. So this is very important over here. Okay, these are questions are normally asked in the interview. Okay, so when the logic lamp is lit, now as we have 2 status indicator, one for your logic and one for the output light. So when the logic lamp is lit, what does it indicate? It indicates the logic to turn on. The output device has been sent from the processor. Processor may analog logic high signal. सेंड केलेलं आहे आउटपुट डिव्हायसेसला, म्हणजे तुमचं लॉजिक पर्यंतचा प्रोसेस एक्झिक्यूट झालेली. वेन द आउटपुट डिव्हाइस विल ऑन, ओके, सो इन सेम केसेस वेन द आउटपुट लाईट इज ऑन, इट इंडिकेट्स द करंट इज ऍक्च्युअली फ्लोईंग टू द आउटपुट डिव्हाइस. ओके, दुसऱ्या केसमध्ये काय करतो, आउटपुट डिव्हाइसचा जर लाईट ऑन झाला, आउटपुट एलईडी जर ऑन झाला, तर तो काय इंडिकेट करतोय की तुमच्या आउटपुट डिव्हाइसमधनं ऍक्च्युअली करंट फ्लो होत आहे. आउटपुट इंडिकेटर विल ग्लो ओनली वेन द ऍक्च्युअल करंट इज फ्लोईंग थ्रू द आउटपुट डिव्हाइस. ओके, स्टेटस लाईट्स आर दस व्हेरी इम्पॉर्टंट टूल इन ट्रबल शूटिंग. दस इट शुड बी असर्टन दॅट द स्टेटस लाईट इंडिकेट. वॉट द स्टेटस लाईट इंडिकेट, सो दिस इज व्हेरी व्हेरी इम्पॉर्टंट थिंग. Okay, so if you are going to say this is, okay, so this particular thing is very very important. Okay, is it clear to all of you? This is very important, whatever the status indicator that we have discussed, because these are the questions which are commonly asked in the interviews, and now you are in the third year. Okay, so from the sake of interview as well as from the sake of exam oral, these are very important things, and these are the things which will actually use in the industry. Okay, say construction wise and all these things, when you know all these details, then only it is possible for you to understand the working of this one. Okay, now the second part that we are going to discuss is the AC output module. Now what is that AC output module? The AC output module standard voltage are 120 volt or 240 volt, as most industrial solenoid valves and starter coils are designed for this voltage. Okay, so if you are going to discuss the AC input module voltage, okay, now what is the voltage? If I am going to see, most of my industrial solenoid valves and the starter coil are designed to operate on 120 volt or 240 volt AC, 230 volt AC. A 8 circuit AC output module for 240 volt is shown in the figure, okay, that we are going to discuss right now. One wire of each output device is connected to neutral. Now see the connections over here, this is very important, this is commonly asked in the exam also. One wire of each output device, pratyek output device chi ek wire tumhala neutral la connect kelili aahe, neutral of the AC supply. The other terminal of the output device are connected to the output terminal of the module, and the second terminal is connected to the output terminal of the module. The hot wire means your phase, okay, is connected to the common terminal on the output module. Okay, so hot wire is normally called as phase, and secondly this is the neutral wire. Okay, so hot wire means the live wire, phase is also called as live, phase is also called as hot wire, and secondly this one called as the neutral wire. Now in this case, if you are going to see what they have done, they have connected phase to the common, and neutral is connected to the one terminal of your output device, whatever the output device that you are going to use. So when that particular device is get active, the current will flow through the system while like this one. Okay, so this is the direction of flow of current, and internally all the terminals, output devices are connected internally to the common. Okay, so there is an internal connection between all these one. So these are connected internally like this one. This system you are not supposed to show in the exam or in the diagram, but this is the internal connections over there. Okay, so now how they are connected, the make the connections. The neutral of the supply is connected to one terminal of your output device. Neutral of supply is connected to the one terminal of your output device. Okay, and what about that hot wire? The phase is connected to the common terminal. Okay, so when that particular output devices get energized, okay, so when one is written over here, so at that time this switch will close over here. Okay, so when basically what happened, when one is written at the output terminal, So this is connected. Now internally this will be like this one. So when this is connected to this one, when one is written and the current will flow through this one. Okay, so this is the path for the flow of current. Okay, so when the processor will write one for the particular output device, at that time that output device will glow, and if the processor will write zero, then it will stop over there. Okay, so this is how your system will actually working. Okay, now for each input and output there must be one table, that is called as the, say, output image table and input image table. There must be an image table for each input and each output. The internal circuit for one terminal of output module is shown. Okay, so they either SC or a TRIAC may be used as a switching device. This is the internal circuitry. They have shown the one internal circuitry for this one. And in that this case, they are going to use either SCR, silicon control rectifier, or TRIAC as a switching device that can be act as a switch. Now in that whatever the circuit they have just given for us, in that circuit we are going to just discuss about the SCR based circuit. This is my silicon control rectifier based circuit. Okay, so we will discuss the working of your AC input module, AC output module with SCR based circuit. So a circuit using SCR is shown in the figure. Okay, when the signal from the processor appear to the for the energizing the solenoid coil, the RC potential divider is energized and capacitor will start charging. Okay, so basically what happens, when your processor will write one over here, okay, when input from the processor is one, okay, when my processor will send the signal one to this one, at that time what is going to be happen, processor appear energized the solenoid, the RC potential divider is energized. This RC potential divider, this one is a R and this one is my capacitor, will energize and the capacitor start charging. So when this get energized, my capacitor start charging at particular value of capacitor voltage V. Okay, at particular value when the capacitor will start charge, its value voltage across the capacitor go on increasing, and at particular voltage V, turn on and capacitor will discharge through it. Okay, so UJT, this UJT will turn on. So UJT will turn on at 5 volt plus V. Okay, what is the voltage across the voltage given by that processor plus voltage across the capacitor, V plus VC. This UJT will turn on, and when this UJT will turn on, my capacitor will discharge through the UJT. Okay, so my capacitor will discharge through this path from positive plate to the negative plate. So this is capacitor will discharge. So during the capacitor will discharge, what is going to be happen over here, this particular say it is work as a pulse amplifier, so this will give signal to the gate of your SCR. So my SCR will turn on. Okay, so when the SCR will turn on, my signal will flow from like this one, this one to this one, this one to this, okay, this to this, this to this, and this. Okay, so my output will get activated for the positive half cycle. For the negative half cycle, the signal will flow in the opposite manner, or my signal will flow like this one for negative half cycle. Okay, so from this one to say for negative half cycle, how it is flowing? Like the for negative half cycle, my current will flow from this, this to this, this to this, this to this, and this to okay. Okay, so for the positive half cycle it will flow like this one. The pulse does get applied to the primary of pulse transformer. Now when this is going to be happen, my pulse is get applied to the primary of the pulse transformer. Okay, so a pulse does get applied to the primary of pulse transformer connected to the base of UJT. Now this pulse transformer is connected to the base of your UJT, so that causes the pulse to be applied to the SCR. This pulse is transferred to the secondary side. Now whatever the pulse is there, this pulse is transferred to the secondary side of transformer and get applied between the gate and cathode of SCR. okay, so my SCR start conducting, and because of this the SCR will trigger, on and will start conducting if its anode is positive with respect to the cathode. Now to achieve the current flow through the load on both half cycles of the AC voltage, a bridge rectifier is used to provide the continuous DC supply to the SCR. Okay, and for that purpose what happened, for applying the current on both half cycles, we are going to use the bridge rectifier. This bridge rectifier will supply the current during both half cycles. So during positive half cycle, if you are going to see, during positive half cycle my current will flow through this one, like this one, okay, and during negative half cycle my current will flow, okay. So during negative half cycle, if you are going to say, the current flow will be like this one, okay. So during positive half cycle, if I am going to just give the name to this one, so during positive half cycle my 1 and 3 will conduct, okay, and during negative half cycle my 2 and 4 will conduct, okay. So that will maintain the continuous DC supply across the SCR, and SCR will always remains in the forward bias state, so it will be continuously, that causes the continuous current to flow through the SCR over this one, okay. Now to achieve the current flow through the load on both half cycles of the AC voltage, bridge rectifier used to provide the continuous supply to the SCR. Instead of pulse transformer, so instead of using a pulse transformer, we may use optocoupler or optophototransistor, optoisolator can be used to energize the triac for switching on supply to the output device. So I can use either a triac or I can use either, okay, so I have n number of options for be used. Instead of using this pulse transformer, I can use optoisolator, I can use optocoupler over there also, okay. So this is basically the working of your AC output module. Now to summarize that, we are going to discuss what in details. Now okay, so when one from your, so when the processor will give a high signal, logic high signal, okay, to energize the solenoid valve, at that time what happens, this RC voltage divider circuit will energize and your capacitor start charging. When the capacitor is fully charged with the voltage VC, at a voltage V plus VC, your UJT will start conducting, UJT will on, and at this voltage when the UJT will on, your capacitor will discharge through the UJT, and during discharging the current will flow through the pulse transformer. So when the current will flow through the pulse transformer, that will induce the current in the secondary of the pulse transformer, induce the voltage in the secondary of the pulse transformer. This induced voltage in the secondary of the pulse transformer will trigger the SCR, which is connected to the gate, okay. So we SCR will get triggered. So when SCR will trigger, the SCR becomes on. When the SCR is on, it will work as a on switch and your current will flow through the SCR. Now when my current is flowing through the SCR, say I have 4, I am going to use a bridge rectifier over here. My bridge rectifier has 4 diode, okay. So during positive half cycle as well as during negative half cycle, my current is also, that bridge rectifier will always maintain the SCR in the forward bias condition, means in the conducting state, okay. So during forward state, okay, during the positive half cycle my diode 1 and 2 will conduct, and during negative half cycle my diode 3, okay, and my diode 4 will conduct, okay. So this is how my SCR will maintain it in the working state, okay. So this is the basic working of your output module, AC output module. In AC output module, either you are going to use SCR or you are going to use the triac, okay. So here we are going to use the SCR in this circuit. In some circuit, instead of SCR they are going to use triac also. The working is nearly same for both cases. Now DC output module, when you are going to just discuss about the DC output module, the working of DC output module is somewhat similar to the working of your AC output module, but it is comparatively simple. what is going to be happen in case of the DC output module. So DC output modules are available from the voltage range of 12 volt DC to 240 volt DC. Okay, suitable voltage and current ranges, okay, has to be selected by consumer according to the load requirement, and we are going to just select this as per the load requirement of the customers. The operation of DC module is similar to AC module, except that instead of SCR and triac, power transistor can be used. So in case of DC module, we are going to use power transistor to switch on the power to the output devices. Okay, so here I am going to use the power transistor. This power transistor is used to give power to the load. And in case of AC module, we are going to use SCR or triac. When connecting the output devices to the output module, say if I want to connect the output device to the output module, one terminal of all output devices are connected to the negative of the DC supply, and positive terminal is connected to the common terminal of the module. Okay, so when connecting the output device, if you are going to say this is my output device over here, okay, so load is my output device. When connecting the output device to the output module, one terminal of output is are connected to the negative. So one terminal is connected to the negative, okay, negative of the DC supply, and the other terminal of is connected to the other terminal is connected to the positive of the DC supply. Okay, and we are going to use a fuse for the protection purpose. Now a power transistor has quickly switching capability than SCR and triac used in the AC module. Therefore, response time of DC module is faster than AC module. So, what are the advantages of DC module? The DC module's response time is more than the response time of your AC module, just like SCR or your triac. So, how it is going to be operated over here, that we are going to discuss now. Now, when my processor will write a logic one over here, okay, say my processor has written the logic one over here. So at that time the LED will glow. When the LED will glow, the phototransistor will on. When the phototransistor is on, at that time what it will do? It will switch on the power transistor. Okay. So when my power transistor is on, my current will flow through this one. Positive, positive fuse, fuse to power transistor to load, load to the DC supply. Or as well as some current is flowing through this one also. To the indicator and indicator to this one. This is the status indicator, output LED indicator. Okay, so there may be two indicators. One is at this location, this indicator is your status indicator, and this one is the this is the logic indicator, logic status indicator, and this one is the output indicator. Okay, so this is how you are working. As it is only a DC supply, so there is no need of using the bridge rectifier or anything over here. Okay, it's working, it's quite simple. When logic one is received from the processor, the LED will glow, LED will emit the light, your phototransistor is on, the phototransistor will switch on the power transistor. When the power transistor is switch on, at that time the current will flow from your positive of the DC through fuse to the power transistor to the load, and load to the negative of the DC supply. At the same time, some current will flow through the output indicator lights. Okay, the resistor is used for reducing the voltage level. Whatever may be the voltage level, that voltage level is going to be reduces over here, because if I am not using the resistor, my this output LED will instantly get damaged. Okay, so the current required for this voltage required for this volt may be 5 volt or 3 volt. Okay, and the voltage that can be used over here, that may be 12 volt DC to the 240 volt DC. So I cannot directly give the this high voltage to the this LED over here. So for that purpose, I need to use the proper rating resistance for this purpose. Okay, now the next point that we are going to discuss over here is the rating of output modules. The output modules have limited current rating. Thus, when the larger loads are to be energized, a interposing relay is used, which is a standard control relay having small inrush and continuous value of current. The contact of control relay are generally rated at 10 ampere. So basically what is going to be happen over here? My output module have limited current rating. Okay, so basically the output module is going to energize the starting mechanism of the output devices. That may be solenoid valve, starter coil or something. The maximum current may be 1 ampere or something that can be handled with the help of output module. So if you want to just operate the heavy load with the help of this output module, you need to provide the interposing relay between the output module and your actual device. Okay, is And what is the function of this interposing relay? The function of this interposing relay is that it will, when the larger loads are energized, an interposing relay is used, which is a standard control relay having small inrush current and continuous current value. Okay, large current value. The contact of the control relay are generally rated at 10 ampere, and the current which can be handled with the help of this interposing relay is nearly 10 ampere. The contact of the relays are used to energize a larger size contactor. Okay, when the size of my contactor is large, at that time I am going to use the interposing relay. Okay, the contact of the relays are used to energize the larger size contactor used for motor starter and heating loads. So these contactors are used for starting the motors of 5 HP, 10 HP, 15 HP, okay, 400 HP or heating loads, heaters or say furnaces. At that time I am going to use this interposing relay. Okay, so the connection for energizing the run motor using interposing relays are shown over here. So basically, if you are going to see, this is my L1, okay, this is my phase, this is my neutral. Now this is my output module. So with the help of my output module, I am not directly energizing the contactor, motor contactor. What I am going to energize, I am going to energize the interposing relay over here. Okay, so with the help of, this is my output module, the output module is connected to the interposing relay, is connected to the output module, and the contact of that interposing relay is connected to the motor circuitry. First we are going to energize this interposing relay, and with that interposing relay we are actually energizing the motor contactor. Okay, so this interposing relay can control the current or can handle the current up to, that can handle the current up to 10 amperes. Okay, so this is all about for today's lecture.